feel free to sing with us. And if you're sitting in here, 6 feet apart from one another.
Or 20.
Or 20. Sing along.
One more.
Early in the morning, our song shall is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
And won't you bow your heads with me for a word of prayer? Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning. We thank you for the first Sunday of May. We thank you for bringing us through the last couple of months, dear Lord. It's been awkward and it's been difficult for many. We thank you that as we look to the future, that we believe that we begin to see the light at the end of the tunnel. We pray for our state, for our country, pray for our world, dear Lord, that you'll touch our people here and bring healing to them. Dear Lord, we come here today to worship you and to praise you and to lift your name high. Thank you for your love to us. We thank you for sending your one and only Son into this world. Thank you for the love that you showed through sending Jesus to the cross. Thank you for your love, your forgiveness. We thank you for the resurrection, dear Lord. Prepare our hearts as we move towards Pentecost, as we talk about the coming of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for all that you do, dear Lord. Be with our voices today as we sing. Be with our service today as we praise you and lift you up. Be with everyone at home today, dear Lord. We thank you for all that you do. It's in the wonderful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, let's look to our call to worship today. I'm sure you can find it at the bottom of your worship info sheet out there. If you're looking for our worship info, it's on the event page. It's on my Facebook page there. You'll see a little sheet with the worship info and some of the hymns that we're singing today. Your call to worship will be at the bottom of that sheet. I want you to join in with me this morning. Loving Shepherd, you know our names. You care for us. When we face darkness and death, walk beside us. When we hunger for your love, fill us with your presence. When we are fearful, feed us at your table. May we dwell in the house of goodness and mercy all the days of our lives.
Amen.
Well, we're going to join in our next hymn this morning, and hope it didn't throw you a curveball with that second hymn. Are you good on this one here? It was an oldie. It was out of the inspiring hymns, and I hadn't sung it for a long, long time, so I hope you guys are good today. There is a fountain.
Lose all their guilty
reading this morning is from Matthew 28, verses 11 to 20. Religious leaders make a deal with some of the soldiers to keep quiet about the resurrection, and the Great Commission is also right here. While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed, and this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age." It's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Well, we're moving to prayer at this time, and our greeter, Tammy Whitaker, is out there in the comment section, as I know she is on screen today, and Susan is here running PowerPoint. She also has her phone out and is watching the comment section there. Any prayer requests been mentioned this morning? Anybody we need to remember?
Prayers for allergies.
Mm-hmm.
Prayers for Blaine as he goes back for
yes.
tomorrow for his chemo and prepares for surgery May 14th. Tammy, you see any others?
Let's see. I got to get it. Rhonda has a praise for Kira and Kara Pfeiffer, who are graduating from college today through virtual ceremonies.
Good. Very good. Having to do that online for many of our graduates here in 2020. I want to remember Blaine in prayer as he heads to surgery on the 14th. On May 13th, there's going to be a drive-by on Laurel Hill Road. His address has been shared all over Facebook out there. Hopefully we can all drive by his house, do a little wave, honk the horn, and let Blaine know that we're all thinking about him and supporting him in this time. So.
Oh, yeah. And apparently somebody's having a birthday this coming week, so
yeah,
happy birthday, Mary!
I was gonna spare you. I wasn't gonna
spare you. Yeah, Queen Blue.
Somebody mentioned you out there. So, all right, everybody at home, everybody, the few people that are here in the sanctuary, let's turn our attention over here to my left, and let's sing a little happy birthday to her. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Carrie. Happy birthday to you.
32.
Thank you very much.
May 5th, folks. Make sure you flood her Facebook page with some comments and send her a little happy birthday out there. All right, let's head to prayer at this time. If you have any other requests, feel free to post them out there. I'll get them later. Feel free to text me or message me any of the requests you have this week, and we'll make sure that we get your prayer requests lifted up. There, let's bow our heads at this time. You can't use the altar here at church, but you can turn around and use your chair at home. You can use your couch at home. You can turn wherever you are into your altar to kneel today. Feel free to do that, to join hands in prayer with your family at home, and let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Dear Father, we thank you. We thank you for listening to us today. We thank you for this chance to praise you and lift you up. We thank you for this time that we can lift our hearts to you, that we can lay what we have on our minds, on our souls, front of your feet, that you'll take care of it. Thank you, dear Lord, for being the one that we can trust, the one that we can turn to, the one that we can depend on. Father, we thank you for being with us through this incredibly awkward time. We'd rather be here in the sanctuary. We'd rather be worshiping together all in one room, and we've had to adjust these last 8 weeks. Pray that you can continue to work with us and help us, dear Lord. Help us to think of others. Help us to put others' needs above our own. Help us to find ways that we can do ministry and reach out to other people and share your love. We may not be able to do it the way that we're used to doing it, the way that we've always done it. We may have to find some different way of reaching out. We thank you for the tools of social media, that we can stay in touch, that we can still talk to people. We thank you, dear Lord, for loving us and being with us. And even though we can be stubborn-headed, even though we can be difficult, you continue to work with us. You continue to move in our hearts. Thank you for all that you do. Dear Lord, be with little Blaine this morning. Be with this guy here who is fighting with all that he has. Be with his family right now. Dear Lord, be with those who are fighting something other than the coronavirus. It seems like that's mostly what we hear about, but there are many, many other needs out there today. Be with those families who are struggling financially and trying to find a way to make it. Be with those who have small businesses, trying to find a way to keep their dreams afloat and alive. Be with our doctors, our nurses, our firefighters, and our policemen. Be with those who are struggling to accept and understand in this weird and wacky time. Be with those who would riot and yell and shout. Be with those who are scared and feel like they may be stuck at home for a long, long time. Be with all of us in this world, dear Lord, and help us to look to you for our leadership, for our understanding, for our hope. Thank you, dear Lord, for your love to us. We come together as your people. We come together as your followers, as your church. No matter where we are today, on the other side of the camera, on a couch somewhere, or at a desk at work, we can join our voices together in prayer, remembering words that were taught to us to pray. Your disciples came to you, said, Lord, teach us to pray. You taught them these words. So we join our voices together this morning as we remember our Lord's prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Hey, Jeremy, before we go on, I forgot. My sister Mary, my nephew Austin, and my dad.
Yes. Remember Susie in prayer today. Like many of you out there, Susie gets a shot regularly for some pain and things in her back, and they have put that shot off until
May 19th.
So she is in pain this morning as she's running PowerPoint for us today. So remember Susie, that she can get in a little sooner, and lift her up to the Lord as well. Leave those requests out there in the comment section or text me later today, and we'll make sure that we get those covered and prayed for. I want to make mention of the offering this morning. Thank you for your faithfulness to your church, to your community. And your relationship with the Lord is important, and tithing is part of that, and giving back to the Lord out of what he has given us. Thank you for mailing your offerings in, and the address is up on the screen if you need to send your offering in. It's Thornville United Methodist, P.O. Box 253, Thornville, Ohio, 43076. Thank you for those who have stopped by and dropped your check off or an envelope. And we thank you for all that you are doing around our community, your help with Comfort Food Ministry, your help with the Little Free Pantry Box, your help with Backpack Ministry that goes on at the school and at Grace Lutheran twice a week. It is tremendous, the support and the charity that we have seen around our community. Thank you for doing all that you have done. We're going to move to communion at this time. I'm going to explain to you how we're going to do communion once we get back together. The few people who are here today have communion laid out for them. There's some bread and some cups right there for you. And once we come back together, we're going to have these pre-made communion cups for us here. It has a little wafer in the bottom of the cup. You're going to peel the bottom off, drop the wafer in your hand and eat that. And you're going to peel the top off and drink it, and then it's completely disposable. You can just throw it away. We'll have trash cans around the place. You can drop your cup in on your way out. And that's how we'll be doing things for a little while. I won't have to touch you. You won't have to touch me. You won't have to come down front. You can pick these up right outside the door when you're coming in on Sunday morning. So at this time, we're going to go to communion, and we're going to take a moment to remember what Christ has done for us. He met with his disciples in that upper room. He broke bread at the beginning of the meal, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat." And at the end of the meal, he lifted the cup. He said, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for the sins of many. Take and drink. And as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." So if you're at home today, you have bread or crackers there, take the bread, take the cup, take your juice or your water this morning. Remember what Christ has done for you. God bless you this morning. God bless your families. We are going to look to Nathan and Carrie this morning. They are going to share some songs with us. Thank them for coming and sharing their gifts with us.
Well, thank you for having us. We love being here. This is one of our several home bases. But right now, this is the only place that we're playing, and it means an awful lot to us. I said a little while ago, we're a little rusty. We're very rusty, but we're very thankful for this opportunity to be able to come here and play these songs and spend some time with you all. See humans. It's really nice. Not very many of you, but I'm happy to see you just the same. And happy to connect with all of you out there in Facebook and YouTube world as well. I know there are people from lots of different places who are watching this morning or who will watch later, and we're thankful for you.
This one goes out to my grandma. She lives in Florida now, and hopefully she's doing well. They've had some bad weather and some bad cases down there. So Gummy, if you're out there listening and watching on YouTube and Facebook, wherever we're broadcasting, I hope you're doing well. Love you much. This is a song that she introduced to me, and we're going to do it for you now. It's about How Can I Keep From Singing.
Where the deer is Just
Thank you, Nathan and Carrie. Thank you for being here with us this morning.
Amen.
We're going to look at Colossians chapter 3. We're going to cover the whole chapter today. It's not that long. It's 25 verses there. Colossians chapter 3 reads very similar to what we read in Ephesians 4 and 5 and just over into chapter 6. Paul writes some very similar things to all four of these churches that he covers here, Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians. He writes some very similar things in each book, and each one is made to fit the community that he's writing to. In Colossae, here he speaks to his audience here about living as those made alive in Christ. And then he has a few instructions for Christian households, which reads very similar to the beginning of Ephesians chapter 6. Now let's take a look in our scriptures today. Colossians chapter 3. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eyes are on you and to curry their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for their wrongs, and there is no favoritism. I like how that passage ends. It made me think back over several of the secular jobs I had before I went into ministry full-time. Desired to get into ministry and to work for the Lord in this way, but it was shared with me a long time back. One of my previous bosses, his name was Dave Hoover. Dave was a guy who owned a Radio Shack and an appliance store in from Shelby, Ohio, my hometown. And he just talked about how he wanted to do what he could to serve the Lord and to serve other people through the job that he had there, and that he may not be viewed as a minister or a servant of Christ in that way, but whatever it was that he was doing, he wanted to do it with all that he had for the Lord. Barbara Brown Taylor, famous Episcopal minister and author, wrote a book that we read in the course of study about ministry and life, and she talked in her book about in her mid-20s walking away from the ministry for a while, kind of struggling with her call and trying to figure out what exactly it was that the Lord wanted her to do. She did come back to ministry at a later time, but in that time away, seeking what the Lord wanted her to do, she found that she could do anything and do it for Jesus. The conclusion that she came to, that she wrote in her book, was go to Idaho and pump gas and do it for Jesus. Deliver ice cream and do it for Jesus. Whatever it is that we do, do it for the Lord and do it with all that we have while focusing on Him. The third chapter of Colossians could be used as a summary of the beginning of Ephesians. It could be used to tie in with Galatians. He uses here the language midway through this chapter that makes you think about the fruit of the Spirit that he speaks to the Galatians about. He wants them to put off all of these things, anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from their lips. And he goes on to talk about how they should have compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, many of the things that we find in the fruit of the Spirit that he writes to the Galatians about. Chapter 3 is an interesting chapter in Colossians in that it brings to summary many of the thoughts that he makes through all four of these letters here. Since then, you have been raised with Christ and set your heart on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. How many of us can say that we have truly put off the things of this world and that we are focusing all that we have on Christ? Many of us that would walk in the door would say that we believe that God exists. And then we walk out the door and we go back to our lives and we go back to doing whatever it is that we want to do, focusing everything we have and all of our energies on life in this world, making sure that we get everything that we're entitled to in this world. What does Paul tell his audience to do here but to set their hearts on things above? Set your minds on things above and not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. To the Galatian audience, he would say that he has died, that he has set his life aside, and now the life he lives for God in Christ. How many of us can say that? That we have died to life in this world, and we have lived our life for Christ. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. That's what we're looking forward to someday, is to hear those words that John talks about in Revelation. Well done, good and faithful servant. He cautions his audience here to put to death the things of this world, the things that have to do with life in this world, all the things we would have done before we came to know who Christ is. Those things need to go by the wayside. We need to lay those things down. And he says here that there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Christ stands at the doorway. He knocks on the door. We changed the setup in here today. If you saw the pictures out there, the big blue ladder we were using to put the camera arm is gone. Brought a little miniature version of that backdrop that we used for Christmas Eve in here to shorten that middle piece up. I was sitting in the middle of it today, and Nathan commented that it looked like a doorway as I was sitting in the doorway this morning getting the camera ready to put on the arm, and you might see, we joked around, you might see some video this coming week of me sitting in there giving you a little message, a little devotional this week sitting in the doorway. But our favorite picture, at least my favorite picture, is the picture of Christ standing at the door and knocking. The little doorway made me think of that today. How many of us have heard the knock at the heart of our door? John would write to the audience in Laodicea, and Christ is speaking, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. Whoever will open the door, I will come in and eat with them, and they with me." Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell richly among you as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. There are those in the Christian faith who would take things maybe a little too literally here, and I would make mention of that in this message. Some of our brethren over in the Church of Christ who don't believe in musical instruments on Sunday morning, who sing a cappella, that's fine. The message here is about our attitude that we bring to the worship, not specifically whether or not there are musical instruments in here today. We're thankful for these two who brought their musical instruments today to play for us. Wherever you are gathered today, wherever you are worshiping today, it is about the attitude that you bring to your worship today. It is not about us. It is about Christ. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. What do I need to remind you of when it comes to submitting? The message in Ephesians was pretty poignant and powerful there as Paul spoke to husbands and wives in the fifth chapter of Ephesians. As he spoke to them about submitting and loving, as he spoke to the children about obeying, and about to the fathers about not embittering their children. He even speaks to the slaves in this situation here that they should do their jobs midst of their situations as if the Lord is looking down upon them. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for their wrongs, and there is no favoritism. That is the Great Commission tie in with all of this. Christ goes back to the Father, back to the right hand of power and glory, as Paul mentions here in this chapter, that Christ is seated at the right hand. We have been left with the message and to share that message with the world around us. We have been given this incredible message of grace and forgiveness, and everyone needs to hear it. Everyone needs to know about it. And we are told that Christ will come back when the message has been shared. We can look around the world and we can think everybody has seen and heard. It's been in every country. It's been everywhere around this world. Missionaries have been everywhere. Everyone has heard it. What's Christ waiting for? Maybe not everybody has heard it yet. Maybe not everyone has come to know about the love and forgiveness. We're in the midst of a generation, maybe a couple generations of people. Some of them have no idea what it means to come in here and worship and hear about Jesus Christ. There's a whole group of people out there who need to hear about the love and the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. Who can you share that love with this week? If you're on Facebook, if if you're on social media, even if you're out and about in this world, you got to stay 6 feet away from someone and wearing a mask at the same time. Talk to them about Jesus. They can hear you through that muffled mask on your face. They can hear about the love and the grace and the forgiveness that Christ offers. Wherever you are this week, you can share the love of Christ with someone. Everybody needs to hear about it. We're going to sing one last song today, and we're going to lift our hearts to the Lord. Thank you for tuning in today. If you're tuning in today, that means Jesus means something to you. And we're going to sing about that great love that God has for us through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He lives. It's on 310 in the hymnal. It's also posted out there on my page if you need the words. Thank you, Nathan and Carrie. Thank you again.